Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good evening to you all and a very warm welcome to our concert, Waltzes with Sultans. This evening you'll be hearing very unusual music, unusual because it is not the kind of repertoire that one associates with the Ottoman court. We'll be presenting you a kind of repertoire that the Sultans wrote in the 19th century. In other words, you'll not be hearing modal traditional songs, monophonic oriental pieces, but instead we will play for you marches and waltzes, some of which were written expressly for the Sultans by European composers, as well as other compositions in the European genre by the reigning Sultans themselves or by other members of the Ottoman royal family. The first item you've heard is by the French King Louis XIV royal composer Jean-Baptiste Lully, Marche pour les Cérémonies des Turcs. It was ceremonial music for the French court and written for Molière's famous play, Le Bourgeois Gentilhomme, which was prompted by the arrival of an Ottoman ambassador to Paris in 1669 and first performed at the Château de Chambord. You have also witnessed how accommodating this music is to the Turkish Janissary instrument called Çevgen. Many specimens of such Janissary percussion instruments were fit to find their way to the military bands of Europe in the latter half of the 18th century, who prided in dressing up their soldiers in mock Turkish costumes, so much so that on the streets of London, Royal British regiments marched past St. James's Palace, proudly showing off their colourfully exotic and orientally attired guardsmen. This was a scene, no doubt, witnessed by Yusuf Agha Efendi, who arrived in London in 1793 as the very first Turkish ambassador of the very first permanent mission of the Ottoman Empire ever to be established in a foreign country. The new Turkish ambassador's arrival in London, it seems, was a highly anticipated event. And in December of that year, His Excellency made his first public appearance of all places during a Christmas pantomime at the Royal Italian Opera, or as we know today, Covent Garden Opera House, where he was seen with his entourage in one of the boxes, and according to a report in the Times newspaper, some of the ladies in the audience even went as far as wishing to offer him wine and cake, but the etiquette of the house at the time would not permit it. During this, when the Turkish ambassador presented his credentials to King George III at St. James's Palace. As we commence our concert in London over two centuries later, and in the presence of not only one but two Turkish ambassadors to London, the current and the previous one, we play Cope's ceremonial march and at the same time witness the power of music in encapsulating and keeping fresh the feelings and emotions of a long-vanished historic occasion.
Thank you.
you very much, ladies and gentlemen. One of the earliest recorded evidences of an Ottoman sultan being exposed to the music of Europe was during the reign of Mehmed III in the 16th century, when Queen Elizabeth I of England sent him as a gift a mechanical pipe organ with a clock, built by Thomas Dallam, who was also to go on to build the famous and most magnificent organ at King's College Chapel in Cambridge. Don Quixote Fez, and settling in the Pera district of the city, he soon adapted to his new life. Today, in Turkish music history, we refer to him as Donizetti Pasha, and his tomb is in Istanbul, in the vaults of the Saint Isidore Cathedral near Taksim Square, in the heart of the city, where many opera lovers pass the spot quite unaware of the fact. Donizetti started his work in Istanbul by writing a new ceremonial march for his new patron, and the result was the Mahmudi. On the autograph score dated 1829, Donizetti scribbled a note that he tried to pay attention to the simplicity of the melodic line in order to help his new Turkish recruits learn the piece easily, who were just getting to grips with the rudiments of European music. See what you think of our orchestra. You will be hearing in a moment, was composed by Sultan Mahmud II, who, although invited to Donizetti, made the headlines in Paris as a composer and introduced European music to his court, nevertheless, it seems, continued to compose in the traditional style. In line with the Europeanization of Ottoman music, however, the Sharkö was adapted for the pianoforte and harmonized by Callisto Guattelli Pasha, and published among a set of similar pieces by Breitkopf, the publishers, in Leipzig, in a collection of two albums, copies of which even reached the personal library of Johannes Brahms. In its melancholy syncopated opening, Sultan Mahmud's composition reminds us of the famous early morning Istanbul mists, and it further reminds me of Sir Edward Elgar's arrival to the city on board a steamer in the morning of 25th of September, 1905, when he was finally deposed only after 3 months in favor of his half-brother, Abdulhamid II. Sultan Murad then spent the rest of his 28 years under house arrest in Turan Palace on the banks of the Bosphorus in Istanbul. For all that time, he was never allowed to set a foot outside the high palace walls. The palace, the waltz we shall be hearing now, comes from the exiled Sultan's music manuscript book and is dated 1879. It is transcribed here for string orchestra by myself from his original handwriting, like the rest of tonight's program. Surprisingly, it is a very jolly piece considering the circumstances under which it was composed. To the Sultan's visit to London in 1867, when on the orders of Queen Victoria, a gigantic chorus made up of 1,600 British singers assembled at a concert at Crystal Palace and sang phonetically before the Sultan, an audience of 30,000, an ode in the original Turkish language, Il No Turco, composed by an Italian, Luigi Arditi. On that occasion, as the critic of the Musical Times observed, I quote, "Whether the words which reached the Sultan's ears sounded to him a bit like Turkish, we have no means of ascertaining. But as music is a universal language, we have little doubt that the notes at least found their way to his heart," unquote. Let me repeat the same sentiments for our concert, almost 150 years later, and also in London, and conclude by reading a stanza from the Inno Turco, sung that evening at Crystal Palace on the 16th of July, 1867. I believe its very precious message is still very, very much valid, as it was then, as it is now. All the west with light is glowing, all the east with light ablaze. Eastern light is western darkness, eastern suns bring western days. East and west should join as sisters, side by side their voices raise, singing on the day of gladness, songs of welcome, songs of praise. Thank you. Thank you.
glamorous sports justice as well, and the descendants of these sultans and pashas and everything. Incredible.